So moving on towards lighting, we have some other aspects we need to consider than for displays and some of the other more early applications that I mentioned. The first thing to keep in mind is that there's enormous opportunity here for the benefit of the world in terms of energy savings, which frankly is a better story than almost all the ones you'll hear in terms of energy efficiency, because not only can LEDs have a dramatic impact on reducing our global carbon footprint, but it can be cost effective because the technology has so many advantages over the incumbent. Everybody can do okay. The suppliers can do okay, the end user can do okay, and the environment can benefit if we adopt LED technology. So this projection is by the Department of Energy. In 2010, roughly 700 terawatt hours of energy was consumed towards lighting and for site electricity usage for lighting. And that can be reduced, according to their model, which is a fairly conservative adoption curve, to about half by 2030. That's a big deal. There's not many technologies where you can literally cut consumption by half. And this is really what we're doing by moving from the vacuum tube-like era of conventional lighting to something much more controllable and much more efficient inherently, like LED technology. to give you an idea what that means, because nobody, 300 terawatt hours, what does that mean? It's kind of the equivalent, it's roughly the equivalent of 50 one gigawatt power plants, 50 coal-fired power plants. That what you find is that the incandescents, even though they aren't the largest volume of lamps, because commercial commercial applications tend to dominate the residential, they're huge energy hogs. And so even though they're not as common, the fact that they're so inefficient is there's a huge advantage to replacing them. Also, you remember the roadmap I showed before had LEDs going up to 150, 200 lumen per watt, right? So even then, now you're talking about replacing fluorescence to tremendous advantage. Another thing that's not often talked about, but for example, this is a great example here. This fluorescent tube, which you can't see on camera, but is right above me here, has a raw efficacy of something like 80 lumens per watt. It's extremely poor at putting its light where you need it. So if you calculate the utilized efficacy, there's a luminaire utilization efficiency that we apply to a luminaire like that. It's roughly on the order of 50% or so. So the overall system efficacy can be literally half of what the raw lamp efficiency is. And this is something that where LEDs have a huge advantage, because the source is so small and so directed, you can put the light exactly where you want it. So there's this other factor of two or so that aren't really captured in these plots that we're talking about, the LEDs. So energy consumption's opportunity is a big deal. The reduction is a big deal. 50 power plants, $30 billion a year, 200 metric tons of carbon emissions per year. And if you look at the world, the total savings are about four times higher. The world gets on this. So there's an enormous opportunity here to convert over for a betterment of everyone. I'm going to go now into technology a little bit. LEDs are made very similar to the way silicon ICs are made, same kind of semiconductor processing, different materials. Typically start with a substrate. You deposit there's two common ways to deposit 3-5 materials: metal organic chemical vapor deposition, where you take precursors like trimethyl aluminum, trimethyl gallium, and mix with, in this case, ammonia to form gallium nitride, aluminum gallium indium nitride. Molecular beam epitaxy is another way to deposit materials, more reserved for the university or academic research. It doesn't quite have the throughput capability of MOCVD. So most of your LEDs today are used using MOCVD technology to deposit the layer structure to make the diode. After we have the layer structure down, we can go through standard wafer fab techniques. Again, very similar to what you might do with an IC, except there has to be special consideration for optical issues. These are optical devices. We have to make sure we get all the light out, and that ends up being a big focus, and I'll go into that in some detail. Devices are then singulated by various techniques and packaged into LED-specific packages. These are a couple of those from some of the top-tier suppliers at the component levels today. And then I'll go into a luminaire for a retrofit luminaire, or maybe some built-in new fixture, depending on the product go-to-market strategy of the company. In question. Typical InGaN, GaN LED structure looks something like this. So here you have, again, the conventional approach is like a sapphire substrate. The nucleation layer is grown to form gallium nitride. Gallium nitride is not lattice matched to sapphire, so you can imagine the dislocation density in the crystal is very high, and that's true. There are tricks to reduce the dislocation density that all of the LED suppliers use to try to reduce the dislocation density on the order of 10 to the 8 per square centimeter. So that's about one dislocation per every square micron. That's kind of the good enough point where you can make reasonably good LEDs. Not as good as you could, and I'll talk about that a little bit more later. Your N-type layer, the quantum wells, which are the active emitters, they tend to be 2 or 3 nanometers in thickness, and with the indium nitride composition chosen to choose the color that's required. Typically, there's an asymmetric injection situation. The hole masses are much higher than electron masses, and you need some sort of balancing activity to keep electrons and holes recombining together. And so typically you have what's so-called Algan electron blocker layer is grown on top of the active region here before you finish off with the PGAN material. Electrodes are applied, and if it's an epi-up device like this one, you need some sort of current spreading technology because PGAN, magnesium dopey GaN, tends to be very resistive. And so you need some help to spread the current there. Look at the energy band gap profile. Here's the valence band, a conduction band. You typically have the N-type layers with holes, electrons injected this way, and then holes injected the other way. The object is to get them to overlap and make light. We talk about internal efficiency. Internal quantum efficiency has really two components. There's an injection component and a radiative component. These are not easy to break down. There's a lot of work in the industry and academia trying to break out leakage current versus non-radiative recombination mechanisms. All kinds of opportunity for you guys studying characterization and how to design experiments to really pull these things apart. It is not straightforward. I would submit that well-designed LEDs have injection efficiencies that are very high. I believe the ones that we have at SORAA are very high, but you can get it wrong. If you misplace the junction or you mess up on this Algan layer, you can have substantial leakage in current, and that stuff is you'll never see. It will recombine in the P layers and you're done. Once you get the injected current in the active region, you need to convert that to light, and that's also not for free. It's driven by roughly three mechanisms. Again, this is a fairly simple way of looking at the situation. So we have a so-called ABC model where we consider non-radiative recombination like Schottky-Reed-Hall recombination and defects, spontaneous emission, which is what we like, the bimolecular radiative recombination for electron hole pairs to generate a photon, but we also have Auger recombination. And one of the interesting things, at least in the GaN world, has been over the last 5 years or so, the notion that in fact Auger scattering plays a role even in these wide band gap semiconductors. We published the first paper calling attention to that in 2007 at Philips under a lot of controversy. But when you look at the data, I think it's still supported that in these wide band gap semiconductors, higher lying electron bands and valence bands can play roles that are, again, not so straightforward to figure out. And we do see evidence under high carry densities of consistent non-radiative recombination due to OJ. So this is the gain that we fight every day. Try to get the internal efficiency as high as possible under whatever conditions we want to operate the diodes in. After internal efficiency, so the photons are generated, we got to get them out of the crystal. And you might not think this much of this problem, you haven't looked at it, but it ends up being a big deal because the refractive indices of these materials, either GaN or in the case of Allen gaps, even worse, are very high. And so electromagnetic phase matching boundary conditions require a refraction of waves at the semiconductor ambient interface. And once you go beyond the critical angle, the ray or the light is trapped inside the crystal. And any kind of working device is going to have metal contacts, electrodes, maybe wire bonds, something in it, even dopants, or the active region itself that's going to absorb photons. So you cannot have the photons rattling around inside this chip forever. The light extraction will be extremely poor. Old LED technology with absorbing substrates and just one surface for extraction, typical extraction efficiency 5 to 10%. Horrible. And there's been all kinds of work to try to get that to be much, much better. That's kind of shown here. This is a review paper, again, from several years ago. Back in the early 90s, late 80s, if an LED was bright enough that you could see it, it was doing its job, because most back then LEDs were used as indicators to tell you that your clock radio's on, or you know, you can see this button's turned on, or what have you, or you know, signage, low-level signage. But as we started to get performance better and better, and this is really in the 90s that started to kick off, people realized you could use the LEDs for lighting applications. All of a sudden, focusing on efficacy was a much bigger deal. And so you had all the LED companies at that time starting putting a lot more investment into improving the performance of the LEDs to get the efficiency up. And so there's this dramatic improvement in light extraction efficiency. I won't go into all these details. If you're interested, you can read this paper. I can direct you to it. But the efficiencies went from this 5% regime up to 80%. So 80% of the photons generated in the active layer get out of the chip and are measured and collected, which is pretty amazing. And I'll talk about where we're at now. We're fighting for every 1% and 2%. So SORAA's target right now is a 90% efficient light extraction efficiency. These are some of the tricks that people play. There's various things that you have to deal with. So as I said before, you know, GAN is usually deposited on sapphire. Sapphire has a fairly low refractive index compared to GAN. So you get trapping in the GAN layers against the sapphire. So one common strategy is to pattern the sapphire substrate so light scatters at the growth interface with the sapphire and gets out. So light extraction can be made higher that way. It's also common in those cases to use a, if it's an epi-up device, to use an indium 10 oxide transparent electrode to get more light out of the LED. Another way is to remove the sapphire altogether. So Osram developed what they call thin GAN technology, where the device is inverted and bonded to a metallized carrier like silicon or gallium arsenide or germanium. Sapphires are moved and the GAN is textured to provide a vertical thin film device, and so you get light out of the gallium nitride that way. LumiLeds has an approach where they used their flip chip technology in combination with sapphire removal and roughness to get high light extraction. This is a kind of interesting device because it looks very analogous to a sun power diode, a high efficiency sun power diode. So if you are interested in a very efficient solar device, you can look at LEDs and get ideas about the same kind of thought process and vice versa. And also there's a, if you have a transparent substrate, you can do things like chip shaping. So you know, a parallel pipe is not the best thing if you want to break up this light trapping characteristic. So you can do other things to improve light extraction. What we can measure is external efficiency. So this is photons at the detector versus electrons injected into the diode. And this is how it looks as a function of wavelength. So the in-gap material system is here, Allen gap material system. The Allen gap material system, as I said before, the band gap potentials get really small. When you add aluminum, increase the aluminum mole fraction, you have this really rapid fall off. And this is just because carriers are not confined and they aren't in the direct valleys anymore. So the efficiency gets pretty low. And the temperature sensitivity of the system is very high. In-gap materials are very good in the blue because most people are working in the blue. This result here is our violet result, which we, in fact, just published last week, I guess, in APL, with our, and I'll go through that in a minute. Rapid fall off as we go into the green, and this has some to do with polarization fields, and things like spontaneous and piezoelectric polarization fields get exacerbated as we increase the indium nitride mole fraction. And the other problem we have is the strain issue that I mentioned before, which complicates the performance. But for white light, you're really focusing in these areas, violet or blue emission, down converting with phosphors. And this is how you do it with phosphors. In this case, for a blue LED, can be mixed with a typical common phosphorus YAG, so-called YAG. It's a garnet, a cerium doped garnet, yellow phosphor. Can be mixed, for example, with a nitride phosphorus. There's a family of 258 nitride phosphors, europium doped, that are fairly common. And once you have these three color points, you can mix and match to make anything you'd like. And again, this typical cartoon, you can have a spectrum that looks like this. And basically, the idea is you're matching a black body radiator. This is something we all view as white. And you can see we have to overshoot a little bit in the blue. There's a requisite gap until we get the phosphor emission, and then we track the black body, and then you turn off. So that's how phosphor LED is made. If we want to have the biggest impact near term on energy consumption, you have to go after the retrofit market. There are 30 billion installed sockets in the world. And while it's nice to think about, you know, brand new luminaires that all run on low voltage and are, you know, integrated with the building control systems for the future, and that will happen, it's going to take a long, long time. In the meantime, we have 30 billion sockets that are housing energy-hogging technology like halogen or incandescent or fluorescent. They need to be replaced. So this is really the first market of focus, at least for SORAA. In general, the feedback we had when we were getting into looking at opportunities for LEDs is that typically the quality was insufficient, especially the brightness was insufficient, and it's very expensive. And so we were thinking about ways to deal with that. Another barrier to adoption is light quality, and this is something that I would submit the compact fluorescent guys completely got wrong. There was a huge focus for fluorescence on cost at the expense of anything, because the idea was that the consumer would never convert unless it wasn't cheap enough. What they failed to realize is that people didn't convert because of price. They didn't convert because they hated the light quality. And that's true in the U.S. today. 30 years later, the penetration of CFLs into the U.S. market is like 15 or 20%. It's a complete failure. And when McKinsey went back and, you know, surveyed everybody, residential, office, all these different sectors, to look at these various aspects, lifetime, purchase price, efficiency, light quality is number one in every one of these sectors, with the only exception being the residential consumer, who's real price sensitive, slightly preferring price more than quality, but only a little bit. Every other application, quality is a big deal. We don't want to get that wrong again, and I think there's some risk of that. If you go into SORAA today and just grab some LED product off the shelves at Home Depot, Costco, you may not be getting something that you're going to be happy with when you get home. It doesn't mean there are not good products out there, but there's certainly a risk that there are some products out there that are not so great. As I said before, we've evolved with lighting for a long time, and we expect certain things in terms of quality of light, like color rendering, color uniformity, beam quality, dimmability, all of these things need to be provided. And there's no reason you can't provide these in LED lighting products. The other barrier to adoption outside of quality is the cost thing. You know, fluorescents have done a good job with rebate programs of being fairly inexpensive at the end user level, you know, a few dollars or even less, a dollar a piece for 800 lumen compact fluorescent. LED is about 10x higher than that today. And that this is something that obviously has to be addressed. and I'll talk a little bit about our view, SORAA's view, and how we might address this problem. And it kind of goes back to Moore's law. If you look at the power of the computing industry, it was really driven by the fact that transistor density just increased and increased and increased. And so, you know, what required a mainframe several years ago or maybe a decade ago is probably in your cell phone today. It's on that order, right? There's a huge increase in computing power. There's a similar trend in LEDs at a lumen per square millimeter level. A little bit different, but really it's how much light am I getting from my semiconductor wafer. This is what drives the cost. It drives the size of the fab that I need. It also drives the size of my final product, the light source, the optics, the heat sink I need to design. And what we see, if we look at lumens per square millimeter over the last decade or so, we see a nice strong trend, but is now rolling over. Roland Heitz, who was a components group manager at HP, was the first one to kind of identify this exponential trend in light output, but it hasn't been holding up for the last few years. And in fact, if anything, what you see a lot of the LED companies now doing to try to get more light is not increasing the power density of the LEDs, but it's putting more LEDs into the package. So you have these fairly large packages that lead to fairly large and arguably clunky light system designs. So with SORAA's approach, we decided, you know, why do we have to go down this road? Why can't we do something better? And so we developed what we call GaN-on-GaN technology, which will be the focus for the rest of my talk, to be able to do that. And the idea is to focus on really high power density devices that enable us to go to a different regime in terms of performance, but also in terms of cost.